Would Bitcoin die?
Number one, when have even three governments gotten in a single room and agreed on anything? You take five governments, put them in a room, and you get 20 solutions. You get every government in the world, and basically you have 20 years worth of stalemate over who decides what coffee we're having. I mean, look at the UN. What do they actually achieve? I mean, they argue lots of things, and nothing really happens. Governments, when they work on their own little area, fine. Two governments, eh.
So basically you're saying that even if they tried to coordinate, they wouldn't be able to pull it off?
No.
And then so it would be a piecemeal attempt, and some company somewhere is going to have a full copy of the blockchain to reproduce Bitcoin, receive Bitcoin.
There are more than 17,000 banks, just banks, on this world. Then you expand that into all the savings and loans and everything like that. We're over 64,000. We take merchants, large merchants who do payment processing. We're over 1 million. These are people who, by law, would be required to keep this information. So that would be 1 million nodes. At the moment, real nodes, not people pretending to be, is under 1,000.
There are mining nodes. Mining nodes.
No, I mean nodes. There are multi-homed ones, and I can give you information about some of these things that try and multi-home and pretend to be three or four nodes using different IP addresses, especially some of the, we've got lots of nodes core. I mean, I found there's a Raspberry Pi out there that has eight different IP addresses and pretends to be eight different nodes. It has multi-homed Linux server that has eight different addresses and whatever else. The fun of having neural networks to analyze these things is you can match them. But if we scale, it becomes simple. We have millions of people who would have to keep data, and that's not going to lose anything. It will become more decentralized, not less. So if we look at what we're doing here, zero-conf becomes secure again. If you have lots and lots of competing miners, lots of companies, then zero confirmation mining, well, do you really care, if you're a miner, about trying to rip off someone's coffee? The reason no one would zero conf and as a miner is it costs a lot to mine. And that's going to become more and more expensive per block. If you're talking about trying to get away with a coffee from a shop and double spend that, then the risk of being caught is phenomenally larger. Right at the moment, you are distributed with a transaction in 2.3 seconds to 99.8% of hash power. It takes you about 25, 26 seconds to get to 98% of what people will call nodes. That's because you've got all these little things out there that take a long time. So the reality is, those nodes that people call full nodes do nothing. You've already had 20-something seconds worth of people deciding, validating, and using that transaction before all these little Raspberry Pis decide to reject it. Which means, because they're not mining, if they reject it, nothing happens. The best they can do is isolate themselves from the network and then rejoin what the miners said anyway.
So basically what you're saying is it takes about 2 seconds for all the mining nodes, all the relevant nodes on the network to basically get a transaction, and they've already kind of decided which one wins. But how do we know that some, since we don't have a confirmation, a block yet, how do we know that some miners haven't prioritized one transaction over the other? So say you double spend. Some of the miners may say B, you have two transactions, A and B. Some miners may say A came first, and I'm going to drop B. But the other miners may say B came first, and I'm going to drop A. You won't know until a block is printed, right?
Because you will. You can probabilistically tell. So you can go out there and poll each of these miners. And by polling those miners, you can see what transaction they have. What is the main one? Now, a miner can intentionally double spend their own transaction. But again, it depends probabilistically on their hash power. So if you take one of the big miners at 15%, you have a 15% chance of getting the next block and 15% chance of getting your double spending. That's it. So for a coffee, would you risk your entire business?
So once again, this is a risk-reward balance. It's kind of the same thing as in an election system where, yes, you could have somebody cheating or being falsifying it, votes in an election, but you don't want to be the person who's caught doing that because the risk of getting caught is much higher than the benefit of adding an extra couple of votes. Is that
it's a risk balance. And we saw a miner back in 2013 get up to 51% of the network, and one of their administrators did a few silly things, and their current hash rate is zero. They went from dominant miner to nothing in weeks.
Right.
That's what happens. The market rejects people who try and cheat.
Right. Actually, that's a good point about to counter all the people who say that mining centralization is a threat, because we've seen that once miners start to centralize, the market will punish them.
Yeah.
We'll punish them for it. So the market is the ultimate decider, right? The free market.
And that's what some people don't like. They don't like that they can't control the market.
So these are implementation steps to scale. Is that what it is?
Some of what we're going to do. We're going to moving towards uncapped blocks. And to do that, we're going to have our own version of software, which basically builds on top of Bitcoin Unlimited. So we're going to build on top of it, but have a certified commercial grade version. And we're going to base that not only on the monolithic architecture, but we're building microservices architecture so that you can integrate web services, enhanced databases, and much more. The idea is there shouldn't be one way of doing everything, one wallet, because there are many different use cases. One protocol, yes, but you want a different wallet on your phone. You want a different one for a different country you might be in. You want to spend differently. You want to be able to trade differently as a user and a merchant.
So the last two are kind of interesting. So the last the four and five, let's focus on that. The no SegWit pool. As we know, we're on the verge of a potential fork in the network. So what if SegWit were to activate and you were to continue running a no SegWit accepting pool? What would that mean for your pool? Does that mean you would cause a fork? Does that mean?
No, it just means we'll make SegWit very slow. And one of the things there are a number of different pool strategies, and there's one that's not used at the moment. There's one that requires a high amount of capital, and no one's doing it because the pool operator takes the risk. So no fees, but the pool operator takes all the risk. And if you have enough capital, that's profitable for everyone.
So what's the strategy?
It's a bit complex to go into in 2 minutes. But
what's the effect of the strategy?
The effect is basically probably a 2% benefit for miners. And
who don't do SegWit?
Who use the pool.
Oh, who use the pool. Okay.
On top of that, there's probably a 0.5% no SegWit benefit. So we can maybe make 2.5% over current mining pools. So we'll make it profitable. You come and join us, you mine with us. We utterly reject SegWit, which will slow it down. We'll have our own hash power, and we'll take other people's. And we get to 20-25%. That means if you want to have SegWit, it becomes difficult, slow, has errors, rejects.
Is this slow because your pool will just not put SegWit transactions into the mempool? So
we won't accept them at all. No.
So
if you spend them, we'll basically just reject and ignore.
I see.
We'll validate any blocks that other people mine.
But you would still need to signal for SegWit, otherwise the blocks that you produce that happen to have no SegWit transactions in them won't be accepted by the SegWit enforcing.
That's just a flag.
It's
you put a flag and not do it. So we can say we'll accept SegWit and not accept it. And one of the things, having a gaming history, is that we're very good at DDoS protection. My background, apart from some of the government stuff, has been gaming. And lots of people have tried to DDoS networks we've run, big time. And none of them have ever succeeded. And we're going to bring that into Bitcoin. none of this stuff with BU being DDoSed or anything. We're going to make it painful for people who DDoS networks.
Does that mean we're going to have less transaction spam?
Transaction spam isn't spam. If you're paying a fee,
that's why I use
it's
these.
Valid.
So, one question. What happens if we end up in two different pools? There's a fork, right? How do you protect the Bitcoin holders? It's something you have to be aware of, right?
But forward. We won't be causing a fork. So, the longest chain is Bitcoin. If 55-60% decide that they want large blocks and no SegWit, then, well, that's easy for us. We just ignore SegWit because it doesn't exist.
So would you say that the game, that's kind of what I'm thinking, the game theory here is because there will be some pools that are going to not accept SegWit, look like they accept SegWit, not accept SegWit, make SegWit commit SegWit transactions, confirm 0.75 times or 25% slower than other transactions, then less people would want to use SegWit.
Yes. Okay. It'll be less secure, it'll cost more, and it'll be slower.
But you're not going to penalize the people who actually do want to use SegWit for whatever reasons.
Well, that is penalizing them in a way.
Do
want to use...
They're not going to lose their money, though. They're not going to lose their money.
Well, if they do, it won't be because of me.
Fair enough.
We're just not accepting them. If someone else attacks the network, which they'll be able to do with less than 50%, then someone attacks the network. But I'm not going to protect SegWit. I will protect, as a miner, the rest of the network and what Bitcoin is. But if you have SegWit, you choose, and that's your choice, you choose to be less secure.
So this number five one, flood control-based fees, what is that?
Our idea is basically going back to the original code and putting in a level of fees based on the number of communications going, basically how many transactions. The idea to scale this massively. Now, the idea is, we can flood the network and that'll cause problems. There'll be big
spam.
Blocks.
Yes,
spam. Things people don't like, Satoshi Dice. Or Luke and Backpage and everything like that. How terrible. Backpage used to do 50,000 transactions a day and have now pulled Bitcoin because, well, they have naughty things. Well, at the end of the day, what we end up doing is ensuring that we have different levels. If you want to confirm and guarantee things, you pay more. And we allow people to pay for different sizes of transactions. We allow people to ensure that they can have large consolidating transactions occasionally, or many transactions, whatever else.
So I'm reading this. Does it mean that for 5 cents, I'm going to have a 99% chance of getting my confirm in the next block?
With a large number of transactions.
Over 50,000 transactions in a block? What is that number, transaction number?
That would be transactions 50,000 plus in a block.
In a block, right. Okay.
And if you're a miner and someone's giving you that, then you're earning a lot of money.
Right, so it's the volume, not the volume of low-paying, cheap transactions as opposed to a few very expensive $2-3 transactions. Well, why does the average transaction size of no-fee transactions bigger than the rest? Why is it 2,000 bytes as opposed to 225 bytes?
Basically, you have your base and then additional parts. So it's only part of a full document that'll be released. But the idea is to have your base transaction and then additional fees.
So it's bigger? No fee transactions would be larger size than the paying ones?
No. It would be that and the next and the next and the next.
Oh, you add.
Yes.
So 2 kilobytes
yeah.
for a transaction and add another 225
yeah.
bytes, the more you pay?
Yes. So...
that's how big your transaction
yeah,
could
as
be.
You,
So
you then increase the size each time and have a little bit more so that people can start scaling the network, not just in... Well, one of the things would be it then pays you, every now and again, to lower the UTXO memory pool by consolidating your money. So instead of having lots of little tiny bits of Bitcoin every now and again you make one of these really big transactions and get it through, but put everything into one wallet and sweep it all away so that you're safe. So what the idea will be is I need to know that I will confirm. Great, I'll pay for that. And most people can afford to pay 5 cents. If it's a microtransaction, maybe not. Or every now and again, things will clear because it's a middle of the night time, whatever else. It would be nice to have a free transaction. And we're going to have a certain number of those as well.
Okay, so I think this is our last topic. We're about 15 minutes over. Sorry, Jim. So we're talking about Bitcoin being a business. It's a technology that enables businesses and corporations and banks. How can a business make money from Bitcoin?
There are many different types of business. So what we're going to be doing is looking at companies that consolidate, new forms of exchanges, totally peer-to-peer exchanges. People have said we patent the blockchain. Well, we don't patent the blockchain. We patent things that people haven't even imagined you can do with it yet. Some of those will change things utterly. For instance, we have systems where no one has a private key. The split key system will allow people to securely sign and reconstruct using a Lagrange interpolation a completed signature, although no one ever holds a private key. So you can never break into an exchange and do something like Mt. Gox. No one can steal all the funds. No one can do something without your authorization. And yet, at the same time, you don't need to trust the exchange. It is completely trust-free. No one can steal from you. You can't cheat the exchange. That's fair. So we will do that for things like coin mixing. There will be people who run relay networks, and those will get paid.
So, you mean like the current relay network that Matt Carlin runs?
No, decent ones. Oh. So I know the idea there, but I worked for the Australian Stock Exchange and then consulted to them back in the early 90s, and we ran out a network called Nipper. Some people over here even in Japan know about it. And the Nipper network ran more transactions to the brokers by a factor of 100 than Bitcoin does now. And this was on old Bay Network ASNs, on old 2 meg lines, all this sort of stuff. And they were faster, and they confirmed better. So that sort of relay network, ones that will actually propagate quicker and earn a little bit at the same time. If you want to take 5 cent fees, and you want to share some of that to make sure that you can guarantee that they get propagated to the miners, good. That's a business strategy. If we want to take partly signed transactions and make a mixed coin function to enable better privacy, better fungibility, that's a business function. We want to have tokenization. We want to have auditable tokens. That's a business function. Smart scripting, escrow, contracts, merchant-to-merchant exchanges, the ability to track inventory over the Bitcoin network and have the payment only transfer when the goods arrive, automated. They're enhanced functions. They're things that are going to come.
So finally, I suppose, what's Bitcoin's dream of the future? This looks like a quote by somebody that I might have read from somewhere before.
So, the future. We're going to be in a world where every single transaction can be denominated in Bitcoin. We're not talking occasional purchases or yen or US dollars. We want to see a world where 5 billion plus people use Bitcoin every day. That's what really matters. Banking the unbanked. How do you do that? You make it simple for them. Practically every person on earth now has access to mobile phones. And in a few years, they will be so cheap, so easy to obtain, that there won't be anyone who doesn't. The computational power of your iPhone, the top of the range, 100,000 yen, whatever else type thing that you see at the moment, in 10 years' time, will probably sell for 100 yen. once you get to that sort of power, everyone everywhere can do this.
Wonderful. Well, I think that that about rounds up the presentation. We have maybe quick time for questions. Oh, actually, let me ask first. Is it okay if we go over time? Everybody, like maybe half an hour extra is okay? Because we have one other presentation, which is about SegWit and its legal ramification, potential legal ramifications that Jimmy had scheduled. If everybody's okay, maybe Mina's on Daijoubu.
I can be done by 6:15.
Is anybody at
home? So because you said that, so to SegWit, no, my impact, any curiosity, so to push time.
Does anybody have a maybe we can field like one or two questions for Craig before we go to the next presentation?
Sure, I just have two questions. I'd like to get your thoughts on the Lightning Network, and why not adopt SegWit just for the transaction malleability issues?
Second one first.
Okay.
There's no reason. Malleability actually can be helpful within Bitcoin. So if you're looking at CoinJoin, or you're looking at something like a Lighthouse protocol, or you're looking at anything else where you want to take multiple transactions and put them into one, that needs to be malleable. Now the second part of that is, why do you want non-malleability, and how do you solve that? You want it so that you can chain transactions. That's the only real reason.
That's not something people really want, right?
It's
you're
not.
You're trying to prevent it.
I'm not trying to prevent. Malleability is a different issue. People are talking about it without understanding what it's about. There's one use case for malleability. Let's chain transactions. That's it. That is the only thing. If you write a good wallet, exchange, whatever else, then malleability is not an issue. Mt. Gox did not suffer malleability attacks.
Yeah.
Exchanges don't take your money and allow you to spend them in 10 minutes. The idea that you took your money in and out on a zero conf that was malleated is just utter BS. That never happened. It's made an argument, but it never actually happened. There's no facts to it. No one has lost money in that form because of it. If you get paid to an address, you get paid to an address. It's only an issue, solely, when you have chained transactions.
Is that the kind of heavy Lightning?
Yeah. And the thing is, you don't even need chained transactions for Lightning. If you take other payment network, like yours, they have payment networks.
And yours is the ones who developed their own payment channel network,
yeah.
That's kind of like Lightning, but they're using Litecoin now, right?
They're using they started on Bitcoin, but they moved to Litecoin because it's becoming too expensive. If you're doing a micropayment service where you're taking $3 and your fees are $3, you're no longer competitive. So other people are solving this without having to go onto sidechains or PEG or anything like that. Some of the things we'll be releasing include ways of doing that. In fact, I can give you an unmalleable transaction in script. One of the problems is it's going to cost you money. Because of the way that we have made things non-standard, to get it out to a miner, that means you have to pay too much to make it worthwhile. That needs to change.
Any other questions? Okay, two more questions. You put your hand up first. Go ahead.
I understand Enchain has $300 million funding.
Jimmy!
And where does the money come from? And the second question is the Tulip computer you once said it was you were running the world number 10 top super
17
computer in the world.
Mm-hmm.
Saying you're modeling Bitcoin transactions, mm-hmm. what happened with the computer?
The computer actually got seized by the US government in end of 2016. That was because the US don't like gambling. I wasn't at the time running gambling on it, but the people I was involved with and hosting it ran poker sites. So, unfortunately, because, well, silly takedown. That doesn't really matter anyway because it was a leased deal, so we didn't own the hardware, but they stole 3 months worth of payments effectively because it was paid in advance for another 3 months. We have all the data, we're just trying to figure out how the hell we actually get it out there because we have petabytes worth of data, and we can't just stick it on a website, which you might guess. I mean, backing it up takes 3 months. So I have no idea how the hell we're going to have to figure out how we split it and do that. But
all you have to do is just go down the street to go to Big Camera and buy 1,000 terabyte external hard drives. I'm sure Daisy, you can Daisy chain those together. I'm sure
seven, we
can
yeah.
Right, our data center. Yeah, 1,000 terabyte.
6,000
external hard drive. 6,000 1 terabyte external hard drive. No problem.
No redundancy.
You wanted to answer the $1 billion
Hi everyone, I'm about to talk in a minute. My name is Jimmy Nguyen and I'm Enchain's IP communications and legal officer. You have read in the press some reports about funding for Enchain. Those are, I would say, some conclusion a journalist drew without talking to us. We have not announced the amount of funding we have. I think what some journalists reputable have done is try to approximate what they thought the value of the business and funding is by adding up what has been the largest round of financing that has been raised to date by a blockchain company, estimating what amounts of money that Dr. Wright's former companies in Australia spent in investing of the research and data, for example, that he's talked about that led to the Enchain company, trying to add it all together and decided somehow that's the amount that was funded. We did announce when we announced that the our private equity fund's acquisition of the business that we thought it was the largest acquisition based upon what was known to date as money raised. It's not the amount of funding. I can say that we are, you know, a well-resourced business, well-funded and prepared to take on the big new dream for Bitcoin's future that Dr. Wright has expressed.
So the easy way to put it is we're private equity and we don't need to report to anyone.
Well, okay, so what, I don't know, following on this question, I'm going to play devil's advocate and say, like, what would you say to the people who, I mean, obviously there are companies in Bitcoin space who are very publicly funded by very public people, like DCG Group, Barry Silbert, and MIT, the Digital Currency Group, stuff like that. You know, we can see who's paying them, so we can kind of see what their incentives may be. What do you say to the people who, like, you know, you guys have a lot of money, you say, but we don't know what your incentives are?
Well, I guess the simple thing is, in 2013, we had over 50 staff in my Australian operation. So everyone thinks about what's big in Bitcoin now. In 2013, I had 50 staff, a little bit more then. Some of our people are actually now posting on LinkedIn. We've just in the last week allowed them not be secret. And we've grown since then. We've spent and done whatever else, all this stuff, so that we can get these patents that are starting to become public, and other technology and whatever else that is starting to, what we're going to release soon. Some of the investment you'll see from one of the companies in Australia was public, which meant we had audited books and all the rest, which was always a nightmare because the tax office treated Bitcoin different every time they did an audit, which made our life difficult. So part of why we moved to Britain, it's just a friendlier environment. Not as all the speculation says. At the end of the day, we own a lot of Bitcoin. The simple thing is, if we make the network scale, we make it bigger, my main compensation, more than anything anyone could ever pay me, is the price of Bitcoin goes up. If the price of Bitcoin goes up, I make a lot of money. So that's my pure drive. I want Bitcoin not to go up to 10,000 or 100,000. I want it to be worth millions per Bitcoin. That's it. And that's what we spend money for. Very simple.
Skin in the game. Sorry, I remember there was another question. Yeah.
Okay, Bitcoin Cash. Your plan is associated with something, Bitcoin Cash. Bitcoin Cash, August 1, they are planning to the fork.
Is Bitcoin Cash the new name for Bitcoin ABC? Is
that ABC.
I don't know. Is it?
Yes.
I'm asking.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. They thought of a better name, so they called it. They renamed it.
Well, SBI is not affiliated with Bitcoin ABC, is Enchain?
I know the people there, and I'm friends with some of them. But we will follow the biggest chain.
As would we. We're following the longest chain. So we don't have an active exchange yet, but that is, as stated, our policy. We don't care about Bitcoin politics. We just care about the longest chain.
And we'll also be doing our best to try and make things scale, not just to 2 meg. We want at least 8 very quickly, because if we're going to grow this.
Oh, you mean that you have another plan to fork the Bitcoin?
No. What other plan?
We follow the longest chain.
So whatever.
But do you have you are updated with the Bitcoin Unlimited?
I have a member of Bitcoin Unlimited. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And Bitcoin Unlimited is a membership which the code is governed by what the members vote. That should be written, but Bitcoin Unlimited doesn't own any hash power, so we have no say into what the longest chain might be. Because at the end of the day, software is a software. If you want to have skin in the game, you either own a lot of Bitcoins or you mine Bitcoins.
Or both.
Or mine Bitcoins and own a lot of Bitcoins. Most miners actually keep most of their Bitcoins, actually. That's why they are Bitcoin long. And then that way you get to decide what client you want to run. We are not miners yet, so we don't have what software we run is just going to be the one that follows the longest chain. So we will not run UASF because that will not follow the longest chain. It will clearly say we will fork off if you don't follow our rules. We will never follow that policy. We will always follow a client. It doesn't have to be Bitcoin Limited or ABC or Cash or whatever people call the next one. As long as it follows the longest chain, we may run the software as an exchange node, not as a miner. Any other questions? Okay, so the last presentation, which I'll have to run through it, is Jimmy